Okay, so the, our main objective was to propose a method to measure efficiency, the method that the efficiency that could account for environmental externalities such as pollutions and for production quotas. So the main conclusion, main results is that we show how this method works in a real context, in the context of quotas in the dairy sector in the European Union at the country level.
Gracias por venir. Nada, hoy contamos con la presencia de Magdalena Capelco, del Instituto de Matemática Aplicada de la Universidad de Wrocław, aunque siempre me cuesta pronunciar la ciudad.
Perfecto,
¿no?
Perfecto.
De Polonia. Bueno, sus temas de investigación pues son los de matemática y economía aplicada, eficiencia, productividad. Hoy he visto que Andrés Esguí ya tiene 6 artículos en lo que va de 2019, así que esta progresión.
Pues, ¿ya 6?
Ajá. Llegas a la docena.
Acumulación, todo se acumula, sí.
Y hoy viene a hablarnos sobre un artículo que se titula Modeling Environmental Inefficiency and the Quota System, que obviamente bueno, ya ha sido aceptado para publicación en la revista ONIG. Y bueno, sabéis que Magdalena, que ya ha estado aquí varias veces, habla perfecto castellano, pero no quiere.
¿Cómo que?
No quiere mostrarlo.
No, en este contexto, no. En los papers, mejor no.
Así que adelante, muchas gracias.
Ok. So thank you very much for the presentation and mostly thank you very much for the invitation. I counted and it's already my 6th time here. And I'm already looking forward for the 7th. Okay, so the paper, this is the joint work with Lydia and Juan. In the paper we present, we develop a model to measure inefficiency accounting for mainly for 2 issues, for environmental externalities or for different for the production of bad outputs and for the quotas. Okay. So this is the outline, the usual outline of my presentation. So I will begin with, as usual, the introduction, then the most time I will spend on presenting you our model, on developing our model to measure environmental inefficiency accounting for quotas. And then I will show you the empirical illustration of this method with first of all the data sets, then some results, and finally I will end up with conclusions. So moving to the first part of my presentation, introduction. Okay, so nowadays many types of economic sectors are regulated, no? Are subject to some interventions that control the supply part of production. And one of examples of such policy, of such intervention, are production quotas that limit the production. Such production quotas, they are often implemented in the agriculture sector. Because as we all know, the agriculture sector, especially in the EU context, it's subject to lots of price support programs, and these price support programs, they provide incentives for increasing the production. And within agriculture sector and within our context, European context, one of the important examples of such production quotas are quotas in the dairy sector, in the EU dairy sector, which actually they were introduced in, this system was introduced in 1984 and it was recently abolished in 2015. Why I am talking about this system? Because in our empirical illustration we will we'll show our method and the empirical illustration using exactly the example of this dairy quota system in the EU. Okay, so now a little bit about the literature, about the previous literature. So with our paper we aim to add some value to this first line of research. This research is the literature on the impact of quotas. So in general the impact of quotas was analyzed from different perspectives, such as what we have here, price and income, price uncertainty, and efficiency also. And we focus on efficiency. And looking specifically on at efficiency dimension, so from the theoretical point of view, the theory says on the one hand that that such system will create economic inefficiency, there will be inefficiency of such system compared to the free market policy. On the other hand also the theory says something something opposite, something completely different, that efficiency will improve in such system in a case when efficient producer, good producer will expand their activities at the expense of less efficient producers. So this is what most, more or less the theory says. Then empirical studies, the empirical research on the quotas and efficiency, in general, that they are studies that analyze the impact of quotas on efficiency, or and the results are not clear. Both positive and negative impact of quotas are found. Okay, so our study, we aim to develop this line of research, and the second line of research that we aim to add value, some value, is the literature on the measurement of environmental efficiency. And again, this literature is very wild. There are lots of studies on environmental efficiency, also in the context of agriculture, and also specifically in the context of dairy farms, of the dairy sector. But when we look together at these both strands of literature, when we look at the at this impact of quotas, environmental efficiency, we see that there is no study that considered both issues simultaneously. That when measuring efficiency, there is no study that accounted both for environmental externalities and quotas. And with our study, we aim to fill in this gap of literature. We propose a new method to measure inefficiency accounting for these both issues. Again, no production quotas and environmental externalities. We use DEA. The method is developed in the Data Envelopment Analysis Framework. Regarding the measurement of environmental efficiency, there are lots of approaches developed, and we in our study we focus on the recent approach we develop. We further extend the recent approach by Marty Rasser and Levkov from 2012, so-called by-production approach. Later on, I will explain more about this this approach. And based on this approach, we propose extending this approach. We propose three inefficiency measures: inefficiency in the production of good outputs, of marketable outputs; environmental inefficiency in the production of bad outputs; and finally, the inefficiency with quotas. Also, we show how to aggregate all these three measures to obtain the overall inefficiency performance measures, and we show the empirical, we illustrate it empirically with the data on EU dairy sector. Okay, so this is our aim, and now moving to the method. So beginning with the approach I mentioned, the by-production approach by Marty that we base our method on. So the idea of this approach is that this is the starting point, no? That the production systems are composed of several independent processes. In particular, Marty paper, they split the technology into two. Into two independent technologies. So their idea is the following: that there is a technology for the production of good outputs, for good outputs, marketable outputs, such as production, revenues, etc. Later on, I will also give specific examples, which is denoted as T1, and the second separate technology for the generation of bad outputs, for all these environmental externalities, for pollution, etc. It's denoted as T2. So using DEA, this is the representation, how Marty represented these two technologies. So going more into details, so in this approach, well, as usual in the DEA, we have inputs and outputs, and more specifically the inputs. Marty et al., they distinguish two kinds of inputs, so-called non-pollution causing inputs, so the inputs that are not causing pollution. In our empirical illustration, it's going to be in the agriculture context, it's going to be labor and land. So these are the non-pollution causing inputs. Then the second type of inputs are those inputs that are responsible for this, for these bad outputs, for these pollution-causing inputs. In our empirical illustration, these are cows, the cows which are responsible for all this bad, poor cows, no, for the bad outputs. And we have the outputs, no? So we have this good output, so in our context it's gonna be milk and meat, the good outputs, and the bad outputs, all kinds of, in our example, it's gonna be greenhouse gas emissions, in some two specific types. So this is the idea, to have inputs split it into two groups, and the good outputs, marketable outputs, and bad outputs. Okay. So then Marty et al. They proposed a specific measure for inefficiency, for efficiency in this by-production context. This is based on this on Fahre and Lovell index. Well, I will not explain here a lot because my aim is to show our approach, but just. What we will need is to remember that, okay, it can be estimated in one program, but in fact the estimation, it can be done through two separate programs. So we estimate separately inefficiency for good outputs, because these technologies are separable, and for the production of bad outputs. So this idea we will use in our further extension of this method. Okay, so looking at our extension, so we add to all this, we out the quotas. We have good outputs, bad outputs, and also quotas. So quotas, they restrict the production of good output. In our example, it's they restrict the production of milk. So they basically, taking into account that these technologies are separable, T1 for good outputs and T2 for bad outputs, so the quota, we assume that the quota restricts only the production of good outputs of T1, because it restricts milk. Okay, so we add this restriction of quota, and what is perhaps important to say is that it's not as really a standard technology, because there is, and in fact it occurred that at the country level, when this dairy sector quota was implemented, some countries exceeded the quota limit. So in this context it is possible that this DMUs, decision making unit, they will be outside of production possibility set, meaning that this is not a standard technology, because it is possible to be outside, to exceed the quota limit. And it will be shown also numerically. Okay, so the measure of inefficiency in this context, first, this is still without quota. So we base here on we use directional distance function, output oriented, so we move only outputs. So this program is for the good outputs technology, and this is for T1, and this is for bad outputs technology, still without quota. No, in next slides I will show how it will change when we enter the quota restriction. So we have, so we will have these two separate measures for inefficiency without quota for good outputs, and for inefficiency for bad outputs. And then we also propose how to put together these two inefficiency measures to have this kind of overall inefficiency, overall performance measure. So this is our proposal of this measure. Let me explain a little bit more. Looking at the program, no, the optimal value for the technology T2, it's gonna be between 0 and 1, while the optimal value for technology T1 is gonna be the values larger than 0. So different range of values. To have the same range of values, we need to make this kind of, recalculation. And in this way, we have the same range of values for both for these optimal values for T1 and for T2. This is what is also important. These are inefficiency measures. So larger the values, more inefficiency, the worse performance is, with the zero value indicating zero inefficiency, that is firm which is efficient. And we take, so we recalculate to have the same range of values, and we just take the simple average. So this is the idea. Okay, so this is still without quota, and now what happens if we have quota? So we just add one more constraint for the technology T1. As I mentioned, no, the technologies are separable, the quotas affect the milk, the production of good outputs. So we have one more restriction, and we again have, and T2 is not changing for bad outputs, because the quotas are not affecting bad outputs, at least in our approach. So the only change is with these optimal values for the technology with quota. Again, we have the same issue with the range of values. And additionally, what I already mentioned, that the technology with quota is not a standard technology, because it is possible that the decision-making unit, the country, will exceed the quota. So sometimes the values, the optimal values, will be negative when the country will exceed the quota, and the positive in this case is going to be a measure of standard technical inefficiency. So giving that these are the values can be also negative, we take the absolute values for this optimal values for the beta T1 with quota, and the same idea to get the same range of values, and again the average to have the overall performance measures. So this is the difference how it's going to be with quotas. So like the method, this is all, no, the basic idea of different inefficiency measures, and then how to create this overall inefficiency measures, and then to sum up, to hopefully to understand it perhaps better, to add some further explanation, we have this graphical example of actually this example only considers the comparison between technology for good outputs without quota and technology for good outputs with quota. We don't have here dimension of technology for bad outputs. Okay, so what we can see here? So we have, first of all, we have this unrestricted technology, no, which is enveloping all these DMUs, all these observations A, B, C, D, E, F. So this is unrestricted. Then we assume in this example the restriction, the quota restriction equal to 2. So then with this quota, everything lower than 2 is possible. So this is going to be our restricted by quota technology. But of course, there's also possibility of being outside, no? The technology of exceeding the quota. And now we can have several scenarios, like DMUA. Let us look at DMUA. What is happening? The DMUA, in fact, is efficient, no? It's efficient when considering both, when we consider the quota. It is obeying the quota, it's not exceeding the quota. It is producing below the quota, and it is efficient also without quota, no? So in this case, for DMUA, our measure of inefficiency for without quota and with quota will be equal to zero. Zero inefficiency, this DMU will be efficient in both. So both measures will be equal to zero and we equal to each other. Then looking at DMUB, it is on the efficient frontier, so it's going to be efficient without quota, so inefficiency value will be equal to zero. But as we can see, it is not obeying the quota, it is violating the quota. So inefficiency with quota, it's going to be lower than zero. And we will have this non-fulfillment with quota. Similar case DMUC. Interesting case is DMUD. It is not violating the quota, it is obeying the quota. No, it is within the quota limit. But it is inefficient. So it will have the inefficiency values both with and without quota larger than zero. And as we can see, due to this restriction, the DMUD, of course, is closer to this quota restriction than to the frontier, this unrestricted frontier. So inefficiency will be larger without quota than with quota. No? And actually, we can also decompose this inefficiency into inefficiency due to quota and some bias. No, we call it bias that modeler takes not accounting into not accounting for quotas. So this is quite interesting case. Again, following DMUE, which is obeying quota, but it is inefficient. No, it's not on the efficient frontier. And what is interesting is that in this case, no, inefficiency with quotas and without quotas are equal. They are larger than zero and equal. And DMUF, which is not obeying quota and inefficient in the technology without quotas. So again, for both, for inefficiency with quota, the inefficiency values will be lower than zero, and for inefficiency without quotas will be larger than zero. So there are different options that we can, well, that we can hopefully see in the empirical illustration. So let's see how this method works. Let's see how all these scenarios can be seen with real data. So this is the data that we use for our empirical illustration. It's a country level data, aggregate data. Unfortunately, we didn't have access to farm level data. For sure, it's going to be more interesting to have farm level data. Well, this is the quotas were implemented in the EU. So we have EU countries for 4 years, 2005, 2007, 2010, and 2013. Some countries, unfortunately, we needed to exclude it because the lack of the data for quotas. Some of these countries entered into the quota system a little bit later because of issues of entering to the EU. As we can see, these are these countries that quite recently, well, recently, it's already many years ago, no, that, for example, Poland entered EU, but still more recent than Spain. Okay, so this is the aggregated data, and then looking at the variables to estimate these inefficiency values. So as I mentioned, we need two types of inputs. So these inputs that are not causing pollutions in our illustration, this is agriculture area, land, and labor force. The pollution generating input mentioned already cows, two good outputs, milk and meat, milk restricted by the quota, and two bad outputs. Greenhouse gas emissions from two sources, from cattle manure management and entering fermentation of cattle. The data comes from the most of the data comes from farm structure survey that is published by Eurostat, and specifically data on milk production and quota comes from a market observatory of European Commission. Okay, so using this data, what we get? So first of all, I will show you our inefficiency values for 4 years, no? For the 4 years we analyzed, starting with 2005. So these are our countries, no? Our countries, and we have again, the inefficiency for T1, for good outputs only, for milk and meat. Then inefficiency for bad outputs only, for the production of all these greenhouse gases. And the T1 good outputs restricted with the quota. So what we can see, what perhaps is interesting, well, looking at the technology T1, well, quite many countries that are efficient, meaning with inefficiency values equal to zero. So they are, we have here output orientation. So we expand outputs, keeping the inputs constant. So we, so these countries can, they are the best at producing, no, at increasing the milk and meat, giving the inputs of land, labor, and cows. Then the technology T2 for these bad outputs. So also less countries, but also quite many countries that are efficient in in this production of bad outputs with inefficiency values equal to zero. So in this case, these are the countries that are the best at decreasing the bad outputs, no? At decreasing the greenhouse gas emission, given the number of cows. We are not moving here the inputs, just the outputs. And this inefficiency with quota. So again, possibility of exceeding the quota. So there are countries that in this year violated the quota, exceeded the quota. So these are the countries with these values on efficiency lower than zero. And then zero, which were efficient in this case, and above zero that were inefficient, meaning measuring here the standard inefficiency. What else we could see? Well, we could perhaps look at these different scenarios, like let us remind these different scenarios. So for example, we had this DMUA efficient in T1 and T1 with quota. So let us see. So for example, France, no? France, which is efficient in T1 and T1 with quota. The same Malta, no? Malta, actually these are these two countries that are efficient in all, in T1, T2 and T1 with quota. So this is the DMUA. DMUB, efficient in T1 but violating the quota. So for example, it's gonna be just that's the first country, Belgium, which is efficient in T1 and negative values of T1 with quota, so violating the quota. The case of DMUD, which was inefficient in both. So for example, Estonia, no, which had the inefficiency for T1 and the value of inefficiency for T1 with quota. No? And again, we could decompose here this inefficiency into this inefficiency due to quota and the bias. We had also this DMUE, which had the same values of inefficiency for T1 and T1 with quota. And as far as I remember, there was no such case in this year. And DMUF, that violated the quota and so negative values of T1 with quota and larger than zero values of T1 without quota. That could be, for example, Luxembourg, no, which has the values of inefficiency without quota and not obeying the quota. So more or less we could see almost all scenarios we have seen in our theoretical considerations. Well, moving to the next year, of course, some change, we can observe some change. For sure, less countries that violated the quotas. And again, France and Malta, which are the best in all, no? And then, and we will see that they maintain it in all 4 years. The third year, again, France and Malta, and also Germany, which is the best in all inefficiencies. Again, less countries that violated the quota. And here we can also see the scenarios, the scenario that we haven't seen so far, that one, no, of DMUE, that had the same inefficiency values for both T1 for good outputs and T1 for good outputs with quota, which could be, for example, Ireland, no, or Sweden, which had the same inefficiency values for both. And the last year, similar issues, no? But again, the France and Malta, they maintain, and also the new, that they are efficient in all, and also Netherlands. So this is this exercise, no? To show all these results, different inefficiencies, different scenarios, how we can see it with real data. Then based on this, we also computed overall average across all years to have the idea under which technology we had more inefficiency or less inefficiency. So this is the average. We also tested statistical significance for T1 without quota, T2 for bad outputs, and T1 with quota. So comparing T1 with T2, we have more, we found more inefficiency, less efficiency in T1 in good outputs than in bad outputs. Actually, we're looking at the previous research, there are also some studies that found something similar, that in general in good outputs, more inefficiency than in bad outputs. And of course, there could be many explanations for that. And then comparing inefficiency without quota with efficiency with quota, this is actually not surprising, no? That we have more inefficiency in T1 than in T1 with quota, given that we restrict, no? We add one more constraint, we restrict the technology, so this is, from this point of view of modeling, it's not surprising that we will have more inefficiency in the technology without quota than with quota. Okay, so these are our separate inefficiency measures. And finally, our final result is this. The table is quite big. the overall measures, no? Overall performance measures, just to remind, no? The average that we did for efficiency, for good outputs and for bad outputs, both without quota and with quota. So these are these values of these overall measures for these 4 years we analyzed. So for sure highlighting again France and Malta that sustained the efficient performance across all years in all dimensions. Okay, and also we also computed the average values for this overall inefficiency measures to have the average values across all years. So for without quota, with quota, and we also tested for statistical significance. So this is only the empirical illustration of the method. No? So we are really not aiming here to derive policy implications, etc., because it's aggregated data. We only wanted to show how the method works, how to see all these scenarios. So basically, our results, this is the most important results. I summarized them already. So I can move to conclusions. I think that I was with timing too quick, maybe, or too quick. Okay, so now I slow down finally. Okay, so our aim was to introduce this method, to combine this both literature, to develop a method to measure inefficiency, accounting both for these bad outputs for different environmental externalities such as greenhouse gas emissions, and production quotas. To develop this method, we based on the approach by Marty et al., the bi-production model with these two separate technologies. Using this bi-production and extended it, we proposed these three inefficiency measures: standard inefficiency in this good output, marketable output, inefficiency in bad outputs in the production of all these externalities, and good output with quota. Then we propose how to aggregate these measures to obtain the overall inefficiency measures. And we show how this method works on the example of dairy sector. Well, perhaps the interesting part is how it can be improved, what could be done next. So these are our ideas. For sure it would be interesting to look at the more recent data to see, as I mentioned, this system, this quota system, dairy quota system, it was recently abolished in 2015, so it's going to be interesting to see the years afterwards and look at the issue differently, compare the efficiency perhaps before quota and after quota removal. For sure, all agricultural economists would tell us use farm level data, no? Because in general, everybody for sure would tell us that the aggregated data is not the best data, so for sure. But it is very difficult to obtain the farm level data. In this context, what could be also interesting, we believe, is I was mentioning all the time that the country didn't obey the quota, that violated the quota, and what was happening in fact, that there was some punishment for, so they were, the country needed to pay some fine, no, for when the quota was exceeded. So we believe it would be also interesting to look at this fine, so for these levies that country need to pay for exceeding the quota. And this approach, methodologically, this approach of Marty from 2012, of course, it has been recently developed, criticized, know that the scientific discussion, and there are lots of newer developments by Forsund, Lozano, or Dacpo in the methodology itself, in this Marty approach. So it would be also interesting to try to apply to see using these new developments. Okay, so that concludes my talk. Thanks a lot for your attention. Questions, comments?
In English or in Spanish?
Can be Spanish, okay. Yes.
Me resulta muy rara la tecnología T2.
T2, de los bed outputs?
No,
no, bueno, de los.
Dibujo, ok. Dibujo.
Sí, dibujo.
Es de los buenos.
Ah, de los cuotas. Buenos con cuotas.
¿Se puede interpretar realmente una tecnología del 2 hacia la derecha? Me refiero, si tu objetivo es no superar el 2, ser eficiente cuando te pasas mucho. Parece raro, aunque luego al final en la medida se combine todo, pero me parece muy raro que pueda considerar B eficiente cuando lo que B quería era no pasarse del 2.
No, pero no hablamos que es eficiente, ¿no? Aquí no hablamos
eso.
Solamente hablamos que no.
Se mide la eficiencia respecto. Ajá. Lo que me refiero que veo, no digo que esté, que me resulta extraño. Es esa tecnología del 2 hacia la derecha, porque claro.
No es una tecnología estándar, ¿no? Es.
Claro, tú realmente no quieres maximizar, quieres minimizar en ese trozo. O sea, quiero maximizar hasta el 2 y minimizar del 2 en adelante, ¿no? Entonces, como que una va expandiendo y la otra lo que realmente quiere es contraerse. Entonces, la construcción de.
No, es verdad que
no
es tecnología como lo entendemos, esto es cierto, que no es la tecnología como lo entendemos, entonces, bueno, podríamos tal vez pensar en otro nombre, ¿no? Pero por eso no lo llamamos, en el paper no lo llamamos tecnología estándar, sí, pero no es, sí, estamos de acuerdo, ¿no? Que no es.
Luego al evaluar se está teniendo en cuenta todo, no sé, me preguntaba en ese trozo, por ejemplo, F es mejor que B. O sea, que son cosas, son igual de malas en una. En la I son igual de malas, una produce más, pero.
En términos de violar de cuotas son iguales, aunque, bueno, luego hay que mirar cantidades, ¿no? Que una es peor en violar, en cantidades de violar cuota.
No recuerdo cuál era el vector en el que medíais la distancia.
Los valores actuales de. De los outputs en este caso, ¿no? De los outputs. No, pero yo creo que estamos de acuerdo, ¿no? Yo y mis coautores, ¿no? Que no es una tecnología así. Que no es una tecnología como lo entendemos, es algo.
Bueno, habría que tener información sobre cuánto cuesta, cuánto se penaliza por sobrepasar la cuota. Y claro, supongo que lo están teniendo en cuenta las granjas.
Claro, si se pasan porque les conviene o.
Según te compensa, pues te pasas.
Es otra cosa, los verdad, que las cosas que. Tal vez es más rentable pasar que.
Tecnología como conjunto de posibilidades de producción, la realidad es que B, C y F han sido observados. Ese es el tema, ¿no? Pero sí que es extraño, sí.
Pero como lo que estáis luego escogiendo ineficiencia, a la hora de medir la ineficiencia, no sé, que esa parte cuente cero, cuando te has pasado mucho, que está claro que luego tendrás ese vector más grande para la parte de que te has pasado la cuota, ¿no? Pero no sé, ese trade-off entre una cosa y otra me resulta un poco.
Sí, que no se está en la literatura, o sea, esto es
nuevo. No, en general, la idea esta de cómo. Restringir, ¿no? De verdad es de Fere, yo creo.
Bueno,
que él lo.
Hay El artículo de
Lord Fair. El Lord Fair, que él lo introducido esta idea, pero en el contexto general de regulación, ¿no? De restringir la... Pues sí que la idea existe, ¿no? Pero verdad, luego es la cuestión si esto es tecnología, que no es tecnología, ¿no? No, como sí, lo entendemos.
No, no es por ponerle sí. un nombre, sino, no sé cómo, era un comentario.
Sí.
Bueno, se podría también modelarlo en otra manera, ¿no? No poner la restricción, sino bueno, incluirlo como una variable, bueno, otras metodologías seguro que, pues ya, que tal vez sería mejor de...
No he pensado en ello, no digo que haya una sí. forma mejor, ni mucho menos.
Sí. No, no, siempre hay, ¿no? Esto fue, bueno, una idea que de restringir tecnología que de verdad viene de Ferre. De Ferre y, sí, creo que probablemente con Groskop, ¿no? Con... su mujer, que es su mujer. Gracias.
¿Alguna cosa más?
Sí, yo tengo varias.
Uh-huh.
Una es la suposición de que los productos buenos y los malos
son separables.
Son separables.
Uh-huh.
Es, por ejemplo, con lo de las vacas, si yo quiero producir carne, necesito vacas.
No, no, esto sí que está aquí.
¿Sí?
Sí, sí, sí. Cuando... mirando la idea, ¿no? Entonces aquí, en T1, está todo. No, no, para... todos los inputs están aquí. Entonces, la idea, la diferencia es en outputs. Bueno, que aquí están solamente los good outputs, los milk y meat, pero todos inputs. Aquí están y los... y cows, y land, y labor.
Sí.
Todo está aquí. Y luego aquí es solamente lo que se enfoca en bad outputs. Los bad outputs y caos.
Pero pueden estar correlados los buenos y los malos.
Sí.
Los bad outputs pueden
sí.
estar correlados con los good outputs.
Con los good outputs. Sí, y de hecho. Sí, de hecho es una de las críticas, de hecho es una de las. Lo que he mencionado al final, ¿no? El Forsund, ¿no? Que es un profesor, bueno, muy importante en esta área, él propone esto, lo que tú dices que esto no es cierto, que...
Por eso, entonces, sí. porque las cuotas las utilizáis en la producción, pero
sí.
también las puedo poner en los inputs. Por
uh-huh.
ejemplo, que no me deje utilizar más agua de una cierta cantidad, me podrían poner la cuota en que yo no puedo disponer de más de ciertas parcelas dedicadas al pastoreo, ¿no? a la ganadería o al cultivo de la oliva y demás.
Uh-huh.
Entonces, a lo mejor en este tipo de modelos también se puede introducir las cuotas, no solamente, en un caso sería, ¿qué ocurre si las cuotas las tenemos en los inputs? En este caso las cuotas tenemos en los outputs, pero podrían estar en los inputs.
Ajá, que también, claro, en alguna manera, a verdad, que
España,
también...
que tú no puedes sí. tener más de no sé cuántas hectáreas en producción de oliva, por
uh-huh.
ejemplo.
Uh-huh.
Entonces, eso es una, esto te ponen un cortapisas en el input en vez
uh-huh.
de en el output. Con lo cual, el modelo puede ser distinto y puedes tener las dos cosas a la vez.
Es cierto, bueno, en este caso...
No,
sí.
Es
sí, gracias, sí,
entonces,
sí. Verdad, en este caso...
Incluso las cuotas no tienen que por qué ser limitantes. Sí, o sea, limitantes hacia abajo, sino después hacia arriba. Porque, por ejemplo, yo podría imponer una cuota de... que si vas a producir aceite de oliva, o sea, oliva, como mínimo tienes que introducir.
Ajá, vale, mirando
entonces,
del otro
si
lado.
Si metes esas cuotas en los inputs, entonces te llevas el output bueno, te lo llevas como un input acotado superiormente y el,
uh-huh.
y el output malo te lo dejas como si fuese la producción. Y entonces
uh-huh.
mides la ineficiencia.
Ah, uh-huh. bueno, es
y
una posibilidad,
es
¿no?
distinta, medir la ineficiencia.
A ver si hay datos, ¿no? Pero...
Primero se hace el modelo introduciendo las cuotas en los inputs, tanto por debajo como por encima, y luego te permitiría, modificando obviamente los inputs buenos, en vez de utilizarlos directamente, el inverso, porque cuanto más
uh-huh.
inputs es mejor. Y entonces te saldría la cuota inversa, o sea que los inputs, uno partido los inputs, te da ser mayor o igual que uno partido fusil, ponemos cuota, y entonces el output es la parte mala, y entonces mides la ineficiencia.
Uh-huh. Vale, así hacer un modelo más
modelo
general.
Sí.
Más
no,
general.
Lo primero
sería
es
abajo.
Viendo qué sucede si introducimos las cuotas en la parte de los inputs. Bueno, esto pues son sugerencias que,
uh-huh.
al hilo de lo que contaba, se me ocurrían para intentar evitar el problema este de la separabilidad. Es decir, cómo no tener que tenerlo en cuenta rehaciendo el modelo para
uh-huh.
que sea de otra manera. Porque entonces la producción buena, a ser un input, invertido, pues ahí podemos medir la eficiencia e ineficiencia medioambiental que tiene la empresa, bueno, el DNU que estoy trabajando.
Bueno, sí. Bueno, muchas gracias. Muy interesante, sí.
No solamente no son... La única pega era lo de la siembrabilidad y esta otra forma, a lo mejor para solucionar, es decir, de una forma compacta, medir la ineficiencia medioambiental.
Sí, no, verdad, muchas gracias, muy interesante, ¿no? De cuota, verdad, no lo hemos pensado, porque hemos pensado que la cuota limita y ya, pero puede ser desde arriba y abajo. Esto es, no hemos pensado, por ejemplo, de oliva, ¿no? De aceite de oliva,
sí, no,
que está al contrario, ¿no?
O incluso al contrario, que tengo que invertir, ¿verdad? O sea, tener en al menos una cierta cantidad de superficie en uso, ¿no? Entonces, pues tendrías las limitaciones en los inputs, pero en este caso, tanto cota superior como cota inferior.
No, muy interesante, pues tenemos que ir por un modelo ahora general, ¿no?
Bueno,
y luego... Sí, no, muy interesante, ¿no? Muchas gracias.
Y cuotas en los
beta outputs
también.
Sí, también cuotas,
también
puedes poner.
Ah, y en los beta outputs también. Ah, claro, porque también, ¿no? Bueno, en estos años todavía no había regulación, pero ahora empiezan a regular esto, pues, ¿verdad? Que abra.
Ya.
Sí.
Que el output, claro, que el
también esto. Estará regulado.
Al final todo tiene cuota y no puedes decidir nada.
No, sí que puedes decidir porque tienes que mejorar tu tecnología. Claro, porque el objetivo de las cuotas es mejorar la tecnología. De alguna manera. Sobre todo la imposición de cuotas en los VAT output es una forma de incentivar que la tecnología que tenga sea limpia y sea más eficiente. De hecho, hay que comprar cuotas de CO2 para producir. Y eso es un input.
Sí, sí. Bueno, en estos años todavía no había restricción en esto, pero verdad que ya creo que ya introdujeron recientemente y hay mercado. Y en este contexto de agricultura sí que ya introducen, pero y esto sería muy interesante, ¿verdad?
Desincentivado absolutamente porque es muy barato comprar contaminación.
Sí, ajá.
Es muy, muy barato.
En este mercado.
¿Te resulta rentable contaminar?
Ah, pues otra como con la cuota, que puede resultar rentable, exceder la cuota.
Claro. Pero bueno,
Cool. Combinaciones, ¿no? No es...
¿Más preguntas? Pues muchas gracias.
Gracias.